Welcome to the sixth lecture of the subject, the course Engineering Mechanics ESME301. In our last lecture, we had studied or discussed the concept of equilibrium in engineering mechanics. We have also seen what are the fundamental features of a static equilibrium as well as dynamic equilibrium. We have also seen static equilibrium is of three types, that is stable equilibrium, unstable equilibrium, and neutral equilibrium. And we have understood all these with a given object, like a given cone. And we had tried to understand the physics of an equilibrium of an object under a force system. Today, we will study what is the effect of equilibrium or what are the features of equilibrium, mainly static equilibrium. Today, we will only study the static equilibrium portion in engineering mechanics. That means when a force system is acting on a physical body, how the equilibrium of the forces on that body is established, how the static equilibrium is established. Now, for equilibrium of a physical body under a force system, that is the effect of a force or a number of forces and their effects. Effects means moments of those forces, or moment of the resultant force of these forces, or it may be associated with the couple with the moment. So the sum of all those forces, moments, couples together becomes zero. So this is the first condition of equilibrium. That's why if a number of force systems are acting on a body, say the resultant force is Fr, and the resultant force Fr is at a position of r vector from the given point of reference. So we know the moment is r cross F. That moment is also a vector. The forces are all vectors. The resultant force is also a vector. The resultant moment due to each force system or each force in the force system are also vectors. So the sum of all the vectors are zero. Now we'll see what will happen if the sum, the resultant sum of a number of forces or a number of vectors are zero. Now, the word equilibrium, as we had also discussed in our last lecture, it is a state of no acceleration where the forces and the effects of the forces like moments, torque, they will be balanced. So the static equilibrium means the state of rest of the body. So if this no acceleration is due to a complete rest, then it is a steady equilibrium. If the equilibrium obtained is due to moving at constant velocity, it will be a dynamic equilibrium. So depending on that no acceleration, the no acceleration is okay, but how the no acceleration is obtained, whether the velocity of the object is at all zero or the velocity of the object is constant, either linear, it may be angular, it's constant. So depending on that, if it is zero before and after the force system is applied, then the equilibrium is under static equilibrium. If the velocity, linear or angular velocity, is constant, then the acceleration is zero. Or if omega is constant, then also the angular acceleration is zero. So under these two conditions, the body is under dynamic equilibrium. So the first condition of static equilibrium is net force acting is zero, and this is common for both static and dynamic equilibrium. And second condition is the net torque or the net moment, maybe moment, with the effect of the force system, the combined effect of the force system should be zero. So there should not be any moment. And the object is at rest. So this is under steady equilibrium. Now, if the equilibrium is to be achieved, then the force applied, the active force applied, if it is F1, and if the reactive force is F2, then if since F2 is opposite of F1, so I can write F1 is equal to minus of F2. Why minus? Since F2 is in opposite direction. So this is the force balance along X direction or along plus X direction. So this is the force balance along plus X direction. If we assume this is X positive. And this may be Y positive. So here we are doing for only 1D, one dimensional. So F1 is equal to minus F2 or F1 plus F2 is zero. Why is zero? Because we already know for a static equilibrium, the net force F should be zero. So if the net force is zero, that means what? We are trying to write the force, we are trying to write the equation of force along X. So I can write the sum of all the forces along X is zero. But if the body of the particle is under non-equilibrium, so the applied force F1 and the reactive force F2 are not same. So I cannot write F1 is not equal to F2. And here either F1 will be higher than F2 or less than F2. But always, as we have discussed in the last class, the reaction cannot be higher than action under some exceptional cases. So F1 here is higher than F2. That means minus of F2, the value. Or F1 minus F2. Here F1 is more than minus F2. So F1 minus F2 is equal to F net here. What is the net force here? F1 minus F2. Since, or you can write F1 plus F2. You can write F1 plus F2 is more than zero. Why more than zero? Because the net force is more than zero here. That means the net force is not balanced in this case. See, why not balanced? Because this is the case where the along X direction, along the plus X direction, the force is not balanced. That means there is a unbalanced force along X direction. So I cannot write summation of Fx is zero. That means the sum of all the forces along X direction is not zero. Since it is not zero, so I can say the force balance is not established. So due to the net external force, the object will accelerate, because this will give rise to mass into acceleration. This into give rise of mass into acceleration. Because the net force is not balanced. So acceleration is not zero. And we know if the acceleration is not zero, the body is not at equilibrium. So according to second law, the body will accelerate, so it will not establish any equilibrium. But here, since the net force is zero, according to Newton's first law, if the net force applied is zero, the body, the state of motion of the body will not change here. So the conditions, the first condition of equilibrium is that when a particle is in equilibrium or is in no acceleration in an inertial frame of reference. Why inertial frame of reference? Because we are talking of Newtonian force. So this is also called Newtonian frame of reference. Newtonian frame of reference. There are two types of frame of reference in physics. One is called Newtonian frame of reference, which is also called inertia, because the inertia concept is coming from the inertia force, M into A, inertia, M, mass. This is, all these concepts are given by Newton. So Newton's frame are also called inertial frame. Another frame is there, which is called non-inertial frame or accelerating frame. Okay, so this I will come later on. Accelerating frame will come in case of D'Alembert principle, of where we are trying to establish a dynamic equilibrium. When a particle is in equilibrium or in no acceleration mode, then an inertial frame of reference, in an inertial frame of reference, the vector sum of all the forces acting on the particle is zero. Because here we have seen how Fx, summation of Fx is zero, has established the equilibrium of the body along x, or equilibrium of forces along x. Similarly, if it is a 3D object, so equilibrium of the forces along y will also be zero. Similarly, equilibrium of the forces along z will also be zero. So if we combine these three, we can write the equilibrium of the net force or the resultant force, Fr, is zero. Now this can be proved in two ways. If the resultant force of a force system is zero, so the forces are zero, the sum of the forces along x, along y, and along z are zero. This can be proved. Or if the net force along x, along y, along z are independently zero, then also the resultant force is zero. That can also be proved. Now, for that, we need to know the generalized system of forces in 3D space. Say, a number of forces Fx, Fy, Fz are acting on a particle, because we are now considering the particle mass. And let us assume that due to the forces Fx, Fy, and Fz, there are also some moments like Mx, My, Mz. Here we are only showing one force, one vector in the moment, which is Mz, and the x, y, z, three coordinates are here, are connecting with point O. That means point O is the reference point, which is the fixed point is this in this space. Now, say, if F is the resultant force of Fx, Fy, and Fz in 3D, so we know that M, the moment, is R cross F. Now, what is R? I already told you in one of my previous lectures that R here is a position vector. Say, this R vector, or the position vector here, is given by x into ex, where ex, ey, and ez are the unit vectors along x, along y, and along z. Sometimes those unit vectors along x, y, and z are also denoted by i, small j, and small k. So ijk. Then we can also write R as x is the magnitude I cap, x dot I cap, plus y j cap, plus x, y, z k cap. Similarly, the force is also a vector. It is having a magnitude as a direction. Say Fx is the magnitude along x, Fy is the magnitude along y, Fz is the magnitude along z, and Ex, Ey, and Ez caps are the corresponding unit vectors along x, y, and z. Also, we can write Fx I cap, Fx Fy j cap, plus Fz k cap. Now, due to the forces there will be moments, or there may be some moments, since fx, fy, and fz, they are not passing through O. They are not collinear. Actually, all these are non-collinear and non-coplanar also. Any two, say fx, fy is in same plane, fy, fz is in same plane, fz and fx are in same plane, but fx, fy, and fz lies in three planes. Plane xy, plane yz, and plane zx. Now, say the moment which is created due to the resultant force, or maybe due to the individual force fx, fy, and fz in this 3D plane, due to this force system, or due to the three forces, three moments are also created, which is mx, which is about point O, my, which is also about point O, and mz, which is also about point O. Since the mx is acting along x, so in the moment of, in the net moment about point O, or the resultant moment, this is the resultant moment, this is the resultant force. The resultant force Fr is having three component along x, fx, along y, fy, along z, fz. Similarly, the resultant moment Mr about point O is having three component mx, my, and mz. And so I can write Mr as expressed as mx passing about O dot I, or I cap, whatever, my about O dot k, sorry, j, plus mz about O dot k. So I have expressed in terms of I, j, and k. That means unit vectors. So this is the vectorian expression of any vector in terms of I, j, and k. If we know the magnitudes along x, y, and z, and if I, j, and k are the unit vectors along x, along y, and along z. Now, you know, moment is also a vector because it is having a sense, it is having a direction, which is R cross F by definition. Now, this moment is about point O. So that R has to be taken from point O up to the any point on the force, up to any point on the force, and this is the force vector. Now, the force vector, I have already got fx I cap, fy j cap, plus fz k cap. These fx, fy, and fz are the scalars, because these are the magnitudes, but this f is the vector, as you can see here. Similarly, for the position vector r, this x, y, and z, these are magnitudes along x, along y, and along z, but the unit vectors are the vectors, or I, j, k. Now, we have to remember that if it is x, y, and z, and if the unit vector along this x is I cap, unit vector along y is j cap, unit vectors along z is k cap. So I can write that, remember, say any vector A and another vector B, A dot B, either the product of two vectors are given by A dot B, or they may be given by A cross B. So the first one is called dot product, and the second one is called cross product. So this is called dot product, and this is called cross product. Now A dot B is expressed by A, that is mod of A, mod of B into cos of the angle between A and B. Similarly, it is given A, or mod of A, mod of B into sine of the angle, that is sine theta. This is the difference between the effect is same. Sorry, the effect of dot product and cross product is not same. This will be broadly discussed in the chapter of vectors. So I dot I, when I will write, so there is the angle is zero. So I dot I is one. I dot I is one because cos zero is one. But I cross I it means 1 into 1 into sine of 0, that means 0. Similarly, j dot j 1, k dot k 1. Similarly, j cross j 0, k cross k 0. But I, now I j k, if you go on either clockwise or anti-clockwise in any continuous I j k, so I dot j equal to k, j dot k is equal to I, k dot I cross j is k, j cross k is I cross k cross I is j. If you go reverse, then negative. Okay, say here it is your k and it is I, so k cross I is equal to j, like this. But it is k cross j is reverse, which is minus I. In this way, if you put this as R and this as F, if we do the calculation, we will get y into fz minus z of fy whole into ex or I plus z of fx minus x of fz into j plus x of fy minus y fx into k. Now, this is the net moment about point O in the direction of x. So this is mx, net mx along O, or about point O. This is net moment about point O in the direction of y. This is the net moment about point O with respect to axis z. So the resultant moment about point O, the resultant moment mr about point O, this can be expressed. Now, this moment is a vector. This moment is a vector. This moment is a vector. So, I have expressed the resultant moment as a sum of three moments. Here, the resultant moment along X, the resultant moment along Y, and the resultant moment along Z are given by mrx, mry, or mrz. Or we can write in the form of summation of m about x, summation of m about y, or summation of m about z. X direction, y direction, and z direction. But all are about point O. All are about point O. So this three components are, will combine or will make the net moment about, or the net resultant moment about point O. So this can be written as the vector. These three are the scalars, dot I cap, because this is the amount of moment magnitude into I cap, plus this dot j cap plus this dot k cap, magnitude along with the dot product of their unit vectors. So if the sum of moments is zero, then the resulting moment MR, and hence the rotational net rotational effect of the body will become zero. That means the body will not at all have a rotating effect. Then the moment equilibrium condition is, if MR is zero, so the moment about any x is zero. Now, if any vector, say A, which is expressed as AX I plus AY of K, sorry, J, plus AZ dot K, if the resultant force or the vector is zero, or is a null vector, then we can write AX is zero, AY is zero separately, and AZ is zero. Because without they individually are zero, if they are, if any one of them are non-zero individually, then the net force or the resultant force or the combined vector cannot be a null vector. So all the components along X, along Y, and along Z are zero. So what is, what we got? First we got if Fx, Fy, and Fz, that means if the net force along X, net force along Y, and net force along Z is zero, then the resultant force about that, the resultant force of those forces acting on the body is zero. Here we have seen, if the resultant moment is zero, all the individual moments, that means the net net moment along X is zero about that point. Similarly, the net moment along Y is zero. Similarly, the net moment along Z is zero. So that three are added in the equilibrium equation. So first we got Fx is zero, Fy is zero, that means the summation of Fx is zero, summation of Fy is zero, and summation of Fz is zero. So these three we got from the net force is zero. Now we got the summation of moment along X is zero individually, summation of moment along Y is zero, and summation of moment about Z is zero. So for a 3D system, if we are having X, Y, and Z coordinate, so the force, both the force and the moment in the force system has to be balanced, has to be in equilibrium. So these six equations are to be satisfied. Clear? So if the net translational force in X direction is zero, that means the sum of the X component forces acting upon the object is zero. That means all the forces along acting along X direction are in equilibrium. Similarly, if the net rotational force about X is zero, that means the sum of X component rotational forces as well as the effects of the force, that is the moments, are in balance or are in equilibrium. The sigma Fx0 means along X direction there is no unbalancing due to force, due to the translational force. Summation of Mx0 means along X direction there is no moment, that means along X direction there is no unbalanced rotational effect. So it is the rotational effect. So moment means the effect which is rotation, rotational effect, or the turning effect. And this is the net translational Translational effect. Translational effect. So equilibrium conditions for the coplanar concurrent forces. Now we have already studied what is the coplanar force. If a number of forces are in same plane, so coplanar, and if they are concurrent. Now the concurrency, they may be either with respect to a point, or they may be with respect to a line. We'll study this in detail later on. When a number of forces act on a particle, the particle is said to be in equilibrium if there is no unbalanced forces acting on it. That is, the resultant force of all the forces acting upon the particle is zero. So this is the equilibrium. The first equilibrium condition is the resultant of all the forces are zero. So force balance. So this is the first equilibrium condition. There are two approaches. One is analytical approach, another is graphical approach. In analytical approach, the algebraic sum of the components along the horizontal plane, that means if it is the plane and if there is a block, the block under a number of forces are trying to be, say, force 1, force number 2, force number 3, say force number 4, whatever. So the block under the action of so many forces, if are to be in equilibrium, so if we assume there's x and y, or instead of x and y, if we write horizontal and vertical direction, so the net force must be balanced along the horizontal direction, as well as there has to be balanced along the vertical direction. Because if both the horizontal and vertical direction for a 2D, why 2D? Because we are studying for coplanar forces. If we go for 3D, then the force will not be coplanar. Because if we talk about the any force along XY plane, so they are coplanar. If we talk about YZ plane, coplanar. If we talk about ZX plane, all the forces are coplanar. But if we talk about XYZ, then there will be three plane, XY, YZ, and XZ. So the forces will not be coplanar. Then I cannot analyze in direction of horizontal and vertical. Horizontal and vertical, we can only determine, say, this plane of the paper. In this plane of the paper, if we assume that there are a number of forces, so all these forces will be coplanar. Say there may be one force, there may be another force. So any two forces are coplanar. Now if they are concurrent, now you see, now if we extend these two forces and they will meet at a point, then they are coplanar as well as concurrent about a point. But if this force and the another force, they are coplanar and are concurrent, they are concurrent since they will meet at a line. So these are called line concurrency. However, for a 2D object, the net forces must be balanced or must be zero, the net force along horizontal as well as along vertical direction. In case of graphical condition or in case of graphical approach of analysis, the force polygon or the force vector must be close. Must be close means, say, we have studied the polygon law. Now, if we draw the polygon, say force F1, then force F2, then F3, then F4, like this, if it is not closed, so that means the last force taken in opposite order will be the resultant force. Now, if it closes, then the resultant force is zero. So in order to get the net resultant force to be zero, that means no unbalanced force in the system, we have to ensure that the vector diagram or the force polygon, as per the polygon law of forces, must be closed in order to ensure a null in order to have a null resultant force or zero unbalanced force. So as we have discussed, as the x, y and z direction or if it is a 3D plane, so there are three directions: x direction, y direction and z direction. Now the type of motion in each direction is of two types. One is translation. In each direction, the body can either translate due to the force and the effect of the force, like moments or couples, or the body may rotate or rotating tendency. Rotation. So there are three axes, x, y, and z. That means three directions. For each direction, the body may translate or may rotate. So how many motion is possible? Six. Three into one, that means three translational motion, and three into one, that means three rotational motion. That means the body can rotate along x, the rotate along y, the rotate about z. So three rotation here. Plus the body can translate along x, the body can translate along y, the body can translate along z. So three rotation and three translation. So total is six. This six is called degree of freedom. Since six degrees of, since the body at a 3D space or a point at 3D space or in XYZ place, say a body is here at a distance R, and the net force acting is say F, net moment acting is say M naught or M. So since the total degree of freedom is six for any object or any particle lying in a 3D plane, so six equation needs to be solved in order to perfectly locate or perfectly describe the state of the body. State means the system, or in order to mention the, or in order to analyze the variable parameters of the body. So how those six equations will come, we already know for a 3D, that the x, y, z plane for any particle body or for any body, we will have three equations. How? One is sigma fx0, sigma fy0, sigma fz0. That means these three are the three conditions for three translation. Now how to restrict or how to write the equation for rotation? So as we know that the rotational effect are due to the moment or couple. That means the moment about x is zero, moment about y is zero, moment about z is zero, is the another three equation which will satisfy the three equation for rotation. So total six, one, two, three, three for force, three for moment. So in this way, the net translational effect and net rotational effect of a body are analyzed, and by using this six degree of freedom, six equations can be written in order to completely describe the state of a body under 3D equilibrium. Clear? Now these are the common types of reactions. Say roller. In the chapter of free body diagram, we have also already studied how to draw the free body diagram of different common joints, supports and reactions, like fixed joint, roller joint, hinge joint, etc. Now this is a ball and socket. In case of ball and socket, the ball can rotate or move in all three directions. That's why all these six degrees of freedom can be given, but the condition is that the ball can only move along X, along Y, and along Z. That means three translational motion could not be restricted. The three translational motions could not be restricted. That's why there are only three unknowns. And those three unknowns are solved by three equations of fx0, fy0, and fz0. In case of a roller, the body can easily translate. So the translational motion is not restricted. What is restricted? The y directional motion or the vertical motion is restricted for 2D. That's why if you want to draw the free body diagram of a roller, the equivalent free body diagram would be a single vertical support if you want to replace the roller. So only one unknown, say F or R, whatever. So only one reaction is unknown, and that can easily be solved by sigma Fy0, because the y direction motion is, if we now consider either y at upward positive, or you can assume y at downward positive. It's your wish, but ultimately from sigma Fy0, we will get, or it is sigma vertical forces are zero, from that we will get the unknown, single unknown, or single reaction force in case roller. But in case of a ball and socket, the three unknown, Fx, Fy, and Fz, because the three rotational motions are not restricted. What is restricted? The ball and, in the ball and socket, the three translational motions are restricted. So we know that how many degree of freedom is six. So six minus number of restraint is actually the number of equation. That means six minus three, three here. Here six minus five, that is one. So here one equation is enough to solve the variable. In case of a single journal bearing, you can see the journal bearing actually two motions are not restricted. What are those? Here Fy is zero. Why Fy is zero? Because the journal bearing is allowed to move along Y. Now this is the X direction. According to their assumption, this is X direction. This direction, the vertical direction is Y, sorry, it is Z. And this direction along the shaft is X, Y. Along the shaft is direction Y or Y axis. Now you can see the shaft can easily translate along Y. That's why Fy is zero. Fy is not taken here. So one equation has been reduced by Fy is zero. Another equation. Now the body can also move along Y axis, because if this is the axis of rotation, the shaft can easily rotate. Otherwise, there is no use of bearing. So the shaft, if rotates, it will rotate about Y. So the moment about Y, you cannot restrict. So by assuming MY to be zero and FY to be zero, because the Y directional translational motion is not restricted, as well as the Y directional moment is also not restricted. So how many? So six minus restraint. That means two. It is four. So four equations are required in order to completely define the 3D equilibrium of a single journal bearing. Four equations. What are the four equations? We have to solve for Fx. What is the, it may balance, it may not balance. If all are zero, then it is under steady equilibrium. If all are not zero, that the journal bearing system is not at steady equilibrium. Fx we have to calculate, Fz we have to calculate, Mx to be calculate, and Mz to be calculate. So Mx, Mz, two moment, and Fx, Fz, two forces are to calculate in order to completely specify the the status of equilibrium of a single journal bearing. Now, this part, the topic of statical determinacy, whether a beam or a physical object is statically indeterminate or determinate structure. So this is mainly very important for civil engineering students. Still, I'm explaining this. When all the forces or all the reactions in a structure, structure means say a bridge or any member in a force system, in a load system, any structure, it may be made of steel or concrete or whatever, when all the forces or reactive forces, that means reactions in a structure can be determined from the equilibrium equations, these types of structures are called statically determinate structure. That means in the last slide we have discussed 6 is the total degree of freedom for a object in 3D minus the number of restraints will give you the degree of freedom. Sorry, not 3, actually F will give you the number of freedom F for this structure. If R is 3, it is 3. If R is 2, it is 4, like this, depending on the number of restrictions. And this degree of freedom is nothing but the number of independent coordinates to completely specify the state of equilibrium of an object in space. It may be 0, it may be 1, it may be 2, it may be 5 also. When it is 6, when it is given in space and there is no ever restriction, then R is 0. So all the 6 degree of freedom has to be calculated. Fx, Fy, Fz, as well as Mx, My, and Mz. But if the if F is 2, if the degree of freedom is 2, that means 2 equations are required in order to completely specify the state. If F is 4, F is 3, so depending on the number of F, that is the equal to the number of required equations to find the to completely specify or find the position or the equilibrium of the body. Now, say the number of unknown is 3. So how many equilibrium equation we need? 3, because this number of unknown is the degree of freedom, F. That means 3 equilibrium equations are required to completely know why it is 3, because it is a roller support. So how many unknown? Only vertically upward force, so R. Here it is a pin joint, say Fx and Fy, or Rx and Ry. Rx. So how many unknown? Rx, Ry, and R. 3 unknown. Only this force P is given in the problem. Since these are, so unless the 3 forces are not known to us, we cannot specify whether that given beam is under equilibrium or not. Thus, 3 equal to 3, that means the degree of freedom is equal to the number of unknown or the number of equations. So, since they're equal, that we can say the structure, the beam is a statically determinate structure. Now, here in this case, what is the type of support? Roller. So what is the force? R in the reaction. Now this R was in Y direction. This R is because the beam can roll along Y, so the reaction is about along X. Okay. Now this P is will be given to you. Now, now here how many forces are there? Say Rx and Ry. Now 1, 2, 3. Now since this is such a joint about which one limb can rotate. Now it can rotate along X, along Y, and along Z. So about this point, say O, we need to find M naught about X, that is Mx, sigma Mx, sigma My, and sigma Mz. How many unknown? Mx, My, Mz, R, Rx, Ry. So six unknown, we will have six equations. So these types of structures are called statically determined. But if the structures having unknown forces, which is not equal to the equation, say we are having four unknowns, but we can only write three equations, or we are having three unknown, but we can write the two equation for 2D. This happens. These types of structures are called, that means the number of equations are less compared to the number of unknowns. That means all the unknowns cannot be determined from the given equations or given set of equations. Those structures are called statically indeterminate. We cannot determine if we do not know any other, say there are four unknown equations. So one unknown has to be given anyhow. Otherwise, the structure will be called statically indeterminate. Now, a very important portion of the equilibrium equation, Lemmas theorem. In Lemmas theorem, the number of forces must be three. The forces must be coplanar, and the forces should be concurrent. It is not written here, so one point is missing. If three coplanar and concurrent, forces acting on a point, say it is a point on a body, say it is a body, assuming a rigid body, so by the way, you can draw it. If three, so the number of forces N cannot be less than three or more than three, will be three. What are the type of force? All the forces must lie in same plane. Say this is a XY plane or YZ plane or ZX plane. So all the forces must be coplanar and concurrent. So they should pass and they should not be concurrent about a line. Rather, they should be concurrent about a point. So if the body is a rigid body, we have to consider or we have to convert the body as an equivalent point body. So under these three conditions, N is three, the forces are coplanar and concurrent. These are the three conditions of Lemmas theorem. If any of the three are not satisfied or is not satisfied or is not justified, then the Lemmas theorem will not be valid. Okay. So for three coplanar and concurrent forces, if the body is under static equilibrium, is in static equilibrium, then each force is proportional to the sine of the angle between the other two forces. Say P is, say here the force P. P will be proportional to the sine of the angle between Q and R, that is alpha. Similarly, Q will be proportional to sine of
beta. The angle between the other, the sine of the angle between the other two. So sine of beta. Well, R is proportional to sine of gamma. Now you can see P by sine alpha is a constant. Clearly Q by sine beta is constant. R by sine gamma is a constant. So you can write P by sine alpha is Q by sine beta equal to R by sine gamma is a constant. This is the Lemmas theorem. If three coplanar and concurrent forces are acting on a body in equilibrium, in static equilibrium, then each force is proportional to the sine of the angle between the other two forces. Now how to prove this? So this is a small proof of two, three lines. The equivalent of this diagram we have to draw. So this is R. So this vertical downward force, say it is R. Say it is P in the direction. So as we are considering a rigid body, we cannot change the direction because there is no intention or there is no right given to us in order to change the effect of the force on the body, whether the body is a rigid body or a particle body, whatever. Q, the direction of Q is upward. So maintaining all the directions same, we have to just put the angles. What is the angle between R and Q? Alpha. So the angle between R and Q is alpha. So this angle is alpha. The angle between P and Q is gamma. So this is P and this is Q. So this is gamma. The angle between P and R is beta. So this is P, this is R, this is beta. There is nothing new. So all we have done from this. So this is the equivalent of this diagram. Now, if this is beta, what is this angle? 180 minus beta. What is this angle? 180 minus alpha. What is this angle? 180 minus gamma. Now, there is a triangle. Say this is, say, point A. This is point B. This is point C. Now, in the triangle ABC, if we can apply the law of triangle, what we can write? We are having a triangle like this, where this is point A, this is point B, this is point C. At point A, R and B, this is R and this is B, sorry, R and Q, and this is P. Okay, the angle at point A is 180 minus alpha. Angle at point B is 180 minus gamma. Angle at point C is 180 minus beta. Now, if we apply the law of triangle, what you can write? The BC, the length of BC divided by sine of the opposite to BC. That is A. Sine M is sine 180 minus alpha. Is equal to, if we take AB, the length of AB divided by the sine of the angle between 180 minus beta. Equal to AC by sine, the opposite angle of AC, 180 minus gamma. Because what was the law of triangle? The law of triangle was A by sine of A by B by sine of B, the length of a side divided by the sine of the opposite angle of the side. is equal to C by sin C, like this. Small c by sin of capital C. Now, what is sin 180 minus alpha? It is sin alpha. And what is the length of BC? Length of BC is P. So, P by sin of alpha. What is the length of AB? It is R. AB is Q. So, Q by sin of beta. What is AC? Is R. So, R by sin of gamma. So, the Lemmas theorem is proved simply by applying the law of triangle. But remember, before applying the law of triangle, we need to convert this given diagram into this triangle. So, because this is delta form, this is star form. We have to convert delta to star. Star to delta. Delta means the triangle form. And star means this form. Means it is the converging form, the diverging form. Is it clear? So simply by using the law of triangle, we can prove the Lemmas theorem. Now, for this type of diagrams, we will try to solve from the next class. Say, for any physical system, if it has to be in equilibrium, a steady equilibrium, obviously, so there should not be any acceleration and the velocity should be zero. That's why if it is a 2D, simply a vertical direction and horizontal direction, we can use this is vertical or this horizontal, or this is horizontal, this is vertical, this is of no meaning. All are same, because whatever we will take is our wish. Okay, but better to assume at X, Y, and Z. If it is a 3D, so we have to remember that the net force, the net resultant force Fr is zero. For that, Fx is zero. The net force along X is zero, so that the body is in equilibrium along X direction, similarly Y, similarly Z. So all the resultant forces along X, along Y, and along Z must be zero for the zero translational motion or the translational equilibrium of the body in 3D. For the moment, we have to also do sigma mx0, my0, mz0. Now, why the moment, when the moment will come? If the applied forces or external forces acting on the body are concurrent and coplanar and concurrent, then the moment calculation is not required, because if you calculate the net moment, it will obviously come zero, because here all the, whatever the point we may take, since the forces are concurrent with respect to themselves or with respect to each other, so the net moment will obviously come. So we can assume for a concurrent coplanar force system, the moments are already balanced. So if we go for the force balance, that will give the solution. So in this case, we can solve it by how many forces? One is T1, or the tension at the bolt on the rope, another tension of another rope from the ceiling, and the weight. So it is a three force system. For a three force system, what do you know? If we wish to apply the equilibrium for a static equilibrium for a rigid body, we can, and if these three forces are coplanar, obviously in the same plane, and they are concurrent at point O, so we can use the Lemmas theorem. Now, this problem we can solve either by using Lemmas theorem, that means P by sin alpha is equal to Q by sin beta is equal to R by sin gamma. We can find, say, the W is given. So in the Lemmas theorem, how many unknowns are there? Say alpha, beta, and gamma, if the three angles are known, out of the three equation, if any one is known, we can find the other. We can find other two. So at least three angles, if alpha, beta and gamma, all the three angles are given. And any two between P, Q and R, any two are given, we can find the rest two forces. So similarly, here all the angles are given. When we will take the value P, that means as a T1, the first force, if we take as a T1, so the opposite angle, the alpha will be 45 plus 90, that means 135. If we take Q as T2, the opposite angle will be 90 plus 30, that is 120. If we take W, the opposite angle will be 105. So we can, so we can apply T1 by sine of 135 degree by applying the Lyman's theorem is equal to T2 by, what is the force? 120. So sine 120 degree, the sine of the angle between the other two is equal to weight, weight is given, divided by sine of 105, sine of 105 degree. So if W is given 1500 Newton, so T1 and T2, see here two equations. When we will find T1, we will find from this, we will find for T2 from this. So T1 and T2 we can easily find. So if we solve these two equations, we will find T1 and we will find T2. Now this same equation we can also find without applying the Lyman's theorem. How? By sigma Fx0, Fy0 and Fz0. Here Fz is not required because there are no z direction forces, so all the forces along z are already zero. So only two equations, sigma fx0 and sigma fy0. For that, first of all we need to break the forces in x and y. This is called resolution of forces. So first we need to know how to resolute resolution of forces in x, y and z direction. Now if it is x, y and z, we require another theory of vector which is called cosine derivatives. But if it is for x, y plane, simple, any force is given, we have to find the x direction value and y direction value. It is very simple. If the force is F, if the force is F and if the direction of the force along any side is theta, and if we can resolute the forces along the plane and vertical to the plane, say any plane, YZ, XY or Y, the main force is F, then if the value of the, if the magnitude of the component of the force along X is Fx and component along Y is Fy, then we can write Fx is F of cos theta and Fy is F of sin theta. So by applying this simple physics of equilibrium of forces, and Fy is F of sine theta. Remember that theta, the angle theta is with the horizontal. If the angle theta is with the vertical, then it will shift. For Fy, it will be F of cos theta. For Fx, it will be F of sine theta. Clear? So that's all for today. In the next class, we'll solve the problems of the equilibriums of a body under two-dimensional force system. We will study how for the concurrent coplanar forces, only by applying the equilibrium equations for the force and without solving for the moments, we can solve the equilibrium equations. We can determine the whether the body is at static equilibrium or not, or if in the question the static equilibrium conditions are given, it is mentioned, that we can find the unknown reactions and forces in the system or unknown moments we can find. If there is a parallel forces in the system, then the moment calculations are very much important, because if the forces are not concurrent, the moments will not automatically become zero. If the moments are zero, or if the resultant moment is zero, when the when a parallel force system are acting on a rigid body, then if the body is to be in static equilibrium, then the net moment about all those forces about a single fixed point on that body or outside the body should be zero. And so next day we will see how the same 2D problem, because the forces might be coplanar. So for a three coplanar and concurrent forces, how by using the Lemmas theorem we can solve a 2D problem, as well as without using the Lemmas theorem, how the same problem can be defined, or how the same problem can be solved only by using the force balance for 2D. Thank you.